Welcome to the Popcorn Talk Network, for the online broadcast network that features movie discussion, news, and interviews. Press one.
Popcorn Talk. We talk movies.
From the Popcorn Talk Network, the online broadcast network for movie talk, this is Otaku Movie Anatomy, breaking down and reviewing some of the best and worst in the animated film genre. Is its power level over 9,000, or is it just another Yamcha? Find out now on Otaku Movie Anatomy!
Traditional dance.
Oh, cool. Now we transition
into the really uplifting orchestral score.
Oh, yeah. Hey, everybody. Welcome to Otaku Movie Anatomy. I'm your host today, ChubbyBunny Michelle. And Yume and Jonathan are out this week because they suck. And we have, however, in place of them, wow, this part of the music's really like.
Yeah, no, it's great.
We have
Emma Fyffe, that's me!
Yeah, you may have seen her on 5,000 other shows on Popcorn Talk or AfterBuzz. And we also have
I'm back! Maxwell Song, as you guys may know or may not. Whatever. That's fine.
Max was stepping in, replacing Jonathan for a few episodes while he was gone in a play.
Yes, in Laguna.
In Laguna. Indeed. With some cool peeps. And yeah, I think it's still going on until the end of the month.
It is. I went and saw it, and it was really fun. Jonathan was great.
Yeah. What is he, exactly?
He is the court jester, basically. He's Snow White's childhood BFF, who is now the court jester to the evil queen, who's played by Marina Sirtis.
Wow.
So it was,
Yep. So, what a scenario.
Tangent, if you're interested in that, you can find information about that at KaibaCat on Twitter, and it'll tell you how to do that stuff. So today we are doing Summer Wars.
Woo!
It's like summer and Christmas, or Christmas and summer, one of those things.
Perfect seasonal movie.
Yes.
Seasonal. I think this movie could have taken place over Christmas break, winter break as well.
It could have taken place over any break wherein you have the opportunity to have everyone not working
come together
yeah. for
except there's
for
a whole
times.
Scene about it being hot, but anyway, we'll get to that.
Yeah, you know,
we'll
the watermelon, all the that. Summer stuff. They're calling it Summer Wars, whatever.
So the genre of this movie is technically fantasy science fiction, but I would even place it with it's like
slice
half
of life.
It's half slice of life and half.
Yeah, it is. It's really interesting because there really are sort of two stories going on concurrently, one of which is very much just kind of your slice of life anime
coming
story.
Of age.
Yeah, exactly. Your slice of life coming of age story. Yeah. And then, of course, the virtual world story, which is very much in the sci-fi genre.
It's very much a Family Vacation the movie.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah.
Except way better than, I don't know, man. I've seen some good Family Vacation movies. Yeah. I just recently saw, what is it, The Great Outdoors, the John Candy.
Oh, yeah.
And
that's
Aykroyd.
A great movie.
I miss all these 80s movies. Oh, and it's a so.
Yeah, it's really funny.
I'm like, whoa, look at these white people. What are they doing on vacation? Sorry. I have a lot of race problems. Anyway, so this movie was directed, it was from Studio Madhouse, back when Mamoru Hosoda was still there. Mm-hmm. Mamoru Hosoda was formerly at Toei Animation and was at Madhouse from 2005 to 2011. I think this was his last movie at Madhouse before he moved on to Studio Chizu, which is his new animation studio. He has directed the first two Digimon Adventure films, which I'm sure Max is
the best. Oh, what? I have a whole thing on that. But the style of Summer Wars is very much like Digimon. And if you actually see the first Digimon movie and you put the Summer Wars like side by side, their things are very like concurrent.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. No, they actually, I had somebody tweet that at me earlier today when I was like tweeting out being like, oh, I'm going to be on Otaku Movie Anatomy tonight. Come hang out with us. They're like, oh, you mean like Digimon the Movie Part 3?
Yeah, some of his critics
have
said that he used Digimon as kind of like a ramp up to get to this movie, as inspiration for this movie. Yeah. And it's, you know, we'll talk about that.
You can definitely tell.
Yeah.
He also did the sixth film in the One Piece series, of which there are 5,000 films.
Yep.
Yeah. He did, in 2006, The Girl Who Leapt Through Time, which is hugely popular, and probably a movie we'll get to at some point. I think Jonathan called dibs on it, which is why we haven't done it yet. And then 2009, Summer Wars came out. And then 2012, he did Wolf Children, which is...
Ooh, nice.
Just get ready for tears.
So much feels.
Just get ready for tears.
That's...
God.
We can't do too many crying movies in a row, or else I'll just stop wanting to come to the show.
Yeah, right.
I've already cried on camera a couple times during the show. So apparently it is according to the internet, Hosoda completed all 500 pages of the storyboards for this film while he was at Denny's.
Denny's, a place of inspiration.
I was going to say, I'm trying to think if I went to Denny's at all when I was in Japan.
Denny's Japan, it's awesome. This was in one sitting. It was, we did it all at Denny's. He didn't do this in his studio thing. In shifts of like 12 to 16 hours each.
Wow.
He just banged
They must have
out.
Loved him at Denny's.
But I was going to say, you know, I actually think I can sort of justify that in terms of like the wide sort of spectrum of characters that we see in this movie. I could imagine like storyboarding in a Denny's and being oh, I'm gonna put that weird guy over there eating pancakes in the movie.
I mean, do you think it would have been a totally different movie if he were in like a Starbucks? You know
what
I mean?
Oh, yeah. The whole cast.
They're all way
just
more
been, like,
chic.
Yeah, they would have just been like hipsters.
Yeah, they're in like Manhattan for some reason.
So I guess, you know, he just really needed to be around people because this movie really, it speaks about generations of people. This movie has a manga adaptation as well. I know a lot of bitches on the internet were like, oh, did you read the manga first? I'm like, that didn't come first, so it doesn't matter if we did on
that. But it does definitely have a bunch of different story things that it does explore.
Now I kind of want to look at it.
I mean, it's for the most part, like, right on him, but there's just, like, little things, like, in the beginning, you kind of see that he has a crush on Natsume.
Yeah, because I will say, like, you definitely got that, like, Natsuki was like a popular, awesome girl, and a lot of people liked her, but they didn't really establish so much straight off the bat that like Kenji was super into her.
That's kind of like, oh, I guess he's kind of always liked her, but like we never really knew. But in the manga, there's always like little panels of him like, oh, just side eyeing her and be like, oh, she's so popular and pretty.
I love to read that, but the manga came after the movie, the movie was canon first.
Yeah, the movie was the source material.
This did very well in theaters. It grossed over about a US $1 million at the opening weekend. This is, you know, in Japan, too, so it's a lot of money there. It won a ton of awards, the Japan Academy Prize for Animation of the Year, Japan Media Arts Festival's Animation Division Grand Prize, very technical terms. And then a prize here, the Anaheim International Film Festival's Audience Award for Best Animated Feature. And it was fucking great. I'm going to just drop all the now.
Yeah.
So real quick in the chat, who do we have here? Is this Summer Wars one of Chubby Bunny favorites? I usually hate standalone movies. This was fucking great.
Yep.
So where is the live stream? Oh, sorry, we were having some technical difficulties, so I can still see you guys on the
interwebs. Yeah, we can see you.
We can see us. Oh, I could see me dancing.
Yeah. So, hi, Starry Cosmic. Hi, Star Drew. Hi, Raziel. Hi, everybody. So thank you for joining us.
Yes.
All right, I'm going to jump into the movie synopsis. I'll try to keep it quick because there's so much happening in this movie.
There's so much to talk about.
So real basically, this dude, Kenji, he's in high school. He's a part-timer working with... as an admin for this thing, the internet called Oz.
Yep.
We'll call it just the internet called Oz. It's basically
the internet
all
Oz.
Aspects of the internet.
Yeah.
You're in it. As
it's
a
like it's basically like an MMO, or if you've ever seen like .hack, Sword Art Online or whatever. It's basically this place that everyone can congregate.
Yeah, and reminiscent also because again, you know, .hack and Sword Art also share this in common with Ready Player One, where it's like a lot of the world's it's not just an MMO.
Yeah. It's like an MMO, but with all the internet.
Yeah,
it's
exactly.
Like if you lived in World of Warcraft.
You know
like,
what?
It basically kind of is already like World of Warcraft.
I guess I'm gonna do it now, but it's very similar to Second Life. Whatever it is you do, but on the internet.
Yeah exactly. Yeah.
Even all the weird, dirty stuff, but also like the important like community gathering and everything.
Right,
you know?
right, exactly. But yet it's all accessed like we would access the internet, because in a lot of those other sort of immersive type anime series and books, in the case of Ready Player One, there's like this sort of Oculus Rift, like full immersion thing going on, and that's not the case with Oz. Like you can access Oz on your laptop, on your phone, on your DS.
So in Oz, which is obviously gonna be very important because they do a whole giant intro with it, first, actually, what happens is Kenji is asked by Natsuki to work a part-time job, which ends up being to pretend to be her fiancé. Yes. When she goes to her ancestral home for her grandmother's 90th birthday, which sounds very convoluted, but it all really makes sense.
It does.
I kept reading synopsis of this, and I was like, what the hell is this movie about? This is my first time seeing it. So basically, he goes there, and while he's there, Kenji receives a weird email on his phone, a bunch of numbers, and he's some kind of crazy math whiz. So he thinks it's a puzzle, solves it. Turns out he cracked the secret passcode that gives you access to everything in
house. The ultimate algorithm.
Which is weird because it's like the whole password is a series of numbers, but is like a passphrase. It's like a whole paragraph of words, and you're like, what does that exactly translate?
Yeah, I wonder, because I just sort of harkens back to a project that I had to do one time when I was in sixth grade or something, where you had to sort of create like number sequences out of words.
God, that was the worst.
Exactly. So it was like A was one, B was two, and you would make these.
It's like decoder ring stuff.
Yeah, right? Exactly.
They try to infer, you know, they're like, well, it's because he's a genius, he can figure it out. It's not very easy.
Why can't the computer figure it out? You think the computer would have a much easier time to figure out this thing as opposed to just other humans
that are smart.
That are good at math, except the computer, which would be way better.
Let's just accept this as part of. Yeah, as part of Kenji is just really, really that smart. Yes. He's smarter than all computers.
Yes.
So he cracks it and hits send, and it's basically gives this AI hacker called Love Machine access to all of the world, and he takes it over. And is basically what this guy named Webske's fault because he created while at CMU in Pittsburgh, which is where I'm from. I took summer classes at CMU. I went to high school down the street from CMU.
So basically, what you're saying is that you actually created Love Machine.
Love Machine virus.
You're the worst.
I'm the best.
You almost destroyed Japan.
So Love Machine is consuming accounts, basically. So he's getting control of whatever the people who own that account had control of. Mm-hmm. And he's screwing up all of Japan. All their trains are fucked up. And all their time and stuff is messed up. And that's kind of a big problem, but then they kind of temporarily fix it. Mm-hmm. They go back to the 90th anniversary the leader of this household is Sakae, and she's this like badass grandmother. Oh my god,
she's amazing.
She's the best. And then like the something like 20 side characters that are all just relatives or children of children that are coming.
They're
to
all family, basically. Yeah.
So Wabusuke is kind of like a black sheep of this family. He comes back and is like, oh, that thing, that was me. And they're like, get out of here. And so she's kind of like trying to make it up to his grandmother. He sold some part of land of their family a long time ago, used that money and like went to America for his, I think for school or something.
For the project to make Love Machine.
Yeah, that's what sent him to the U.S. And basically, he was trying to make it up because the family seems to be, not that they're in financial trouble, but I mean, they're not wealthy. Yeah.
They talk a lot about how they used to be wealthy at the beginning of the movie.
But they have land still, and so they're kind of like living off it.
Yeah.
But, you know, they don't have any sort of like huge property or I guess they have power only in the sense of connections.
Right. And Wabusuke thinks basically that like by creating and selling Love Machine, that now the family is going to have money again like they used to, and that's going to make Prestige, Sakai happy.
But it basically fucks everything up so much the person's account, who is the grandmother's doctor, gets like hacksword, and he doesn't get notified that the grandmother's blood pressure or something, you know.
Yeah, she's supposed to have a weak heart.
Yeah, so she dies overnight one day. I'm skipping a lot of stuff, by the way. We'll get to it later.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's basically Wabusuke's fault. So the family is like, we must take revenge, and they figure out a way to destroy the virus and live happily ever after all together with all of the family working together. And it is like the greatest family working together.
It really is. It's adorable.
It's like they all come together. Mm-hmm. I mean, of course there's fracturing because that's basically what family stands for. Mm-hmm. Then, you know, they come together in just like this kind of big momentous moment.
Yeah.
And it's beautiful.
And it's beautiful. Yeah. So the family, their last name is the Genoches. It's based off of they're supposed to be descendants of samurai, and they talk about it a lot in the movie.
They do.
They're very
like,
this is where we're from. We were just going to tell you now.
Mm-hmm. Of Ueda.
They're vassals of the Takeda clan from way back in the day. I'm talking about back in the day in like 1600s.
Yeah.
So this place is supposed to take, the movie is supposed to take place in the real life city of Ueda, who I think the director, his wife lived there. Her, his wife's family is from some sort of long lineage like that samurai clan. So he kind of like studied his her family, the town, and based like, you know, the apparently that. That like building, that big turret where the family lives, is, like actually exists.
Oh, it, cool. Oh, in Ueda, yeah.
Yeah, it's, that's like, awesome. It's, I don't think there's a house there anymore, but they're still, they have the, it's like this
mountain
turret.
Peak?
It's this big, like, it looks like a giant driveway with this big gate, and that's there.
Right. Yeah. Oh, okay.
I think that's the foundation of the front gate of what used to be a castle.
Right.
And so they live up there.
That makes sense, yeah.
Did it burn down or anything?
I think just everything burned down during the war.
Yeah.
That makes sense.
During World War II, basically everything, nothing really survived that. That was cute that it's real. And it's for those who don't know, Ueda is in Nagano. It's very close to Toyama. No one knows where that is. Never mind. It's in Nagano. Everyone knows where Nagano is.
Yeah.
And then, so the director did admit that he based a lot of Oz, because this is an original story that he got to create with his team. And he did admit that, it's kind of based off Second Life.
Right.
A little bit, but like it's better than Second Life. Is Second Life still around?
Yeah, it's totally still huge thing.
Really?
Yeah.
With
a lot of people. See, the whole thing about Second Life is like a lot of older people use it.
Okay, that makes sense.
They've upgraded their like kind of graphical capabilities now, so like they can even do a lot more things. And of course, it gets super weird because they don't really. The thing about Second Life is like you can basically do anything, like, and I mean anything. I think there were people that got in trouble for like actual prostitution and also like
virtual drugs and prostitution.
And there's also cults. There's also like weird cults, and there's also support groups and stuff. So it's like it's. In that sense, very free.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah, absolutely.
And Oz is also definitely like that. Yep. Even just the fact that you can make your avatar into whatever it is.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, Second Life, like, you can only really be a humanoid, you know?
Yeah.
But, like, I actually thought it was very interesting in Oz that you could just be, like, a little rabbit that's a fire truck or something.
Right.
Or like
the one family member is a Shinkansen. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Like, oh, damn.
The best fighter guy is a giant humanoid, like, rabbit fury. So that's whatever. Like, whatever floats your boat. And I think that's a very interesting aspect of it because then it's like, this is, like, the real internet.
Yeah.
Yeah, no, it's true.
And it's great. I mean, obviously, they added that very artistic element because it's Studio Madhouse. And when you see Oz and you see all the little characters and stuff, and you see the very opening scene is that big white mushroom thing, and everything's kind of circling around it. The style is everyone's like, oh, it looks exactly like Murakami.
That's exactly what I was thinking.
Don't forget, this came out when Murakami
like,
was still really,
super big?
Really, it's still really big.
Yeah.
But it was just getting like super hype back then. Yeah. So
because they had that Louis Vuitton commercial where it was he directed that commercial.
Because
it had the Digimon style to it.
Oh,
it's all coming together. Yeah, because that whole the main Oz like hub or whatever looks totally like that super flat Murakami thing.
Yeah.
Hosoda totally was like, I admire him. I'm not trying to copy his style, but he used inspiration from obviously from Murakami, you can see it on screen.
Yeah, totally.
Very definitely.
But yeah, it's that crazy, popular, super flat style. And, back in the day, that was still very new. And now everyone's using it.
Yeah.
Okay, so
get out of here,
we want to get into this.
Yeah, let's get into the meat of this movie here. We're gonna talk about some of the themes in this film, because there are a lot of them. But of course, one of the main ones that it's, as Michelle mentioned, there's about 20 million side characters, and they are all family members. They're all the children of Sake, they're the children's children and the spouses, and it's all about this big, crazy, diverse, family unit. And it's interesting because, the family starts off with this very sort of surface level, like, understanding of what's, because from their perspective, it's like, okay, this is all about Granny's birthday and, making Granny happy, and we're gonna have a great time. Initially we're seeing people bonding over a celebration, and then again, when Granny dies, the bonding that happens when you are in mourning. And it's really interesting because, and I'll get into this more with some of the other themes in the film, but basically, like, some of the ideas that this movie addresses is, like, what kind of constitutes a family in a way, because you have for the most part, all of these characters are related to each other or related by marriage, but you have these two sort of outlier characters in Kenji and in Wabisuke, because in the case of Wabisuke, like, everyone in the family just like hates him.
Yeah. Except for Natsuki.
Yeah.
And I think it's kind of interesting because Kenji is an outsider, just a pure outsider.
Absolutely.
Like,
yeah.
But at the same time, like Wabisuke is a part of the family, but is also still an outsider. So it's like you're kind of seeing two sides of one just being a pure outsider and how someone could feel if you were in a family like that and still be in part of the family by name.
But yeah, like, absolutely. Well, and it's interesting because I think that like the family thing, again, and this goes back to what you're saying, Michelle, about how they, you know, they reference the fact that they are descended from, you know, these samurai, the samurai clan, basically. And there is that like, oh, you know, it's our family name and all that kind of stuff. But at the same time, I don't think that Granny feels that way. She's much more accepting of outsiders than the rest of the family is for the most part. Because number one, you know, she in the sort of flashback we see with her and young Wabisuke, she talks about how she was just so happy to give him the family that he needed. I mean, he is the illegitimate son of her husband.
Yeah. Right. And that was like a crazy...
And she just welcomed him with open arms. Like,
They inferred that like the grandfather has already died and then her husband already died. His mother is also dead. So that's why he had to come to the family.
Yeah. Sakura is just such a wonderful character, because not only, you know, do we see that she values family so much that it's like anybody who doesn't have a family, I think, is welcome in hers.
Exactly.
Because we also see that she immediately bonds with Kenji.
Yeah.
Much more so than, you know, the rest of the family does. And you know, I'll get into this a little bit more, too. You know, when we have the reveal that Kenji is not who Natsuki claimed he was. No. And she,
and irony, his background was based on Wabisuke. Wabisuke,
exactly.
The black sheep.
Exactly. Exactly. But, you know, and there's this great scene where, like, the whole family is all surrounded. And they're like, he's not who she claims he is. I bet he can't even find the U.S. on a map.
Like, how's that the thing that makes sense?
But, you know, and basically in that moment, Natsuki looks to Sakae for help. And Sakae is just like, I don't care.
I feel like she knew though. Like that's the whole thing is like it's like she could see past all of the lies in a way.
Yeah, absolutely.
You know?
Yeah.
And she just like has this.
Who they really are.
Yeah. I mean, but she definitely had that intuition. Like even in the beginning, like I think she knew that he was a good kid, but he knew that like she was making it up.
Yeah, you know? I think that's totally fair because I mean she's a pretty smart cookie.
And she was when she heard it, she was like, I'm not surprised.
Yeah, exactly. And so of course ultimately, you know, it is the family bonds in the movie as well that end up saving the world, you know, because you know the family basically comes together to challenge Love Machine and
spoilers defeat him.
Yes, to defeat Love Machine. The whole family bonds together and they all get together with their cell phones
like
and
Voltron,
their DSs.
They just combine together.
Yeah, and ultimately it is because, you know, they sort of remember to value one another and sort of value the strength in numbers and believing in the bonds of family. You know, they go to confront Love Machine and ultimately, like, the family comes together to save the world. Things aren't going so well for the family, but then, like, the rest of the world sort of becomes part of the family.
Yeah. Digimon.
Yeah.
Stop it, Max.
It is very much so.
The whole third act is basically Digimon. It's like by the books Digimon.
Yeah.
The director Hosoda did say that he was trying to write a movie that showed relationships between people who have a very close-knit family versus those who have nothing. And it's kind of to show that you make your own family.
Yeah, exactly. Exactly, which is very much what Sakae is all about. Because it's interesting because she is such a sort of selfless character in many ways. And that's another sort of big theme of the film is putting the value of others over your own personal value. So, you know, basically in the midst of the chaos, because basically once Love Machine takes over Oz, everything goes crazy. like, traffic lights aren't working, water mains are breaking, all the elderly people's heart monitors are going off as if they're dying, but they're fine, and nobody can get to where they need to go. So basically, they're all gathering at their, you know, their family's historical home, and it's interesting because they're all there for Granny, but, like, Sakae doesn't really care if they're not all there. Like, they all have this impression that, like, they all need to be there. It's going to be the end of the world if they don't all show up. And they themselves, personally, this one family getting together is the most important thing in the world. But what Sakae does is she goes and, like, starts making phone calls to all the family members that haven't made it yet. Yeah. And everyone she has ever known. And tells them, like, we're going to war. You know, it's chaos out there. Mm-hmm. Everybody needs to do their part to basically, you know, make sure that we get through this crisis. And so, you know, there's that great moment. But then after she dies, the family is still in the same, like, selfish place of, oh, no, poor us. Everything's terrible for us. Yeah. No one can make it here. Our grandmother's dead.
All of our like, material things. Like, you know, they're always talking about, like, the food and have to, like, prepare this and that. And it's like,
exactly.
You know, for them, it was definitely more about, like, just the ceremony of it.
Yes.
Not necessarily in a weird way. It's like, yeah, they are respecting the grandmother, but, like, they're not really, they don't really care what she wants, you know?
Yes. That's absolutely 100% true. Because that's not what she would have wanted at all. And Kenji, who is an outsider, but who very quickly sort of started to establish this bond with her and felt very welcomed, I think, by Sakae into the family, he is like, guys, we gotta, we have to do something.
He stands
something.
Up against one of the aunties, and she was, like, super mad at him. Like,
That was really interesting.
That was a great
moment. And also just, like, the reactions within the family, how, like, the women just kind of, like, took over.
Yeah.
And the men just kind of all sat around being sad.
Yeah, and then one of the uncles does say, you know, he's like, Kenji is really brave of you to stand up to whatever auntie was.
All the women, yeah.
Because in our family, this is a matriarchy, and we just listen.
Yep.
I mean, with a great-grandmother like that, you know? Like,
she's just, a badass,
it's like you would have to be raised as a strong, independent woman, you know?
No, I mean, if you've got her to look up to.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You better be that. More like it.
Exactly. But so, you know, and again, it's like the family is still, like, so caught up in their own grief, but Kenji challenges that, which is what ends up, you know, sort of rallying everybody together, and they have the whole bit where they bring in the supercomputers, Kazuma tries to take down Love Machine himself with his avatar, King Kazuma, who's a famous sort of fighter within Oz, but, you know, ultimately it is Natsuki who sort of sees the light and is willing to sacrifice herself, not only herself, but her whole family, who get behind her and support her in this, and it's like when they realize that, oh, like, our sacrifice could potentially mean everything gets resolved and we can all live happily ever after. That, you know. Exactly. It's all about sort of, like, discovering that selflessness. Like, it's not devaluing like the connection of family, but it's like realizing that you are not the only people in the world.
Right.
Which they certainly come to realize. And in another one of the big things, and, you know, we touched on this a lot with Granny and how the family's just kind of ignoring what she really wants, because there is a lot about lying and perception within the context of the film as well. I mean, that's literally what it starts on, is Natsuki's lie about how Kenji is her fake fiancé.
Which is weird, because they don't really ever get back to about why she did that or what.
No, well,
she said, you know, like, I just wanted to make grandmother happy. Because,
but,
like,
she never shows that she wanted that, though.
Yeah. Of course she didn't. But
no, I think that's something that people can relate to when you get together with your family and you are of a certain age that other members of your family perhaps were settling down.
I feel like it's more of, like, they have an expectation of what they're supposed to do, as opposed to what people actually want.
That is exactly what it is. And it transcends into Natsuki also creates this person who she thinks her grandmother would want her to be with.
Yeah.
But she doesn't care. Like,
no, she
again,
doesn't.
As I said, you know,
she's a badass.
Like, yeah, that great moment where it's like she doesn't, you know, she doesn't care that he's not the person that she pretended he wasn't. And she has a great moment, Sake and Kenji, where she's saying, you know, can you make Natsuki happy? Mm. I know she made up this fake fiance thing,
yeah.
But she's a good girl. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And
you know, Kenji's totally up for it, too. Kenji's like, yes.
I'm up for the challenge.
Yeah, and she, and you know, Sake, like, she totally believes him. And she's like, mm-hmm. yeah, you're genuine. You're going for a genuine place.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And if you read the manga, you would know exactly what I'm talking
read
about.
Read the manga, bitch.
Read the manga.
Yeah,
I wanna, so good.
Definitely, definitely want to check it out. So, yeah, it's really interesting that you see, like, mm-hmm. all of the family members going to these great lengths to make Sake happy, mm-hmm. but it's not what Sake wants at all.
Right.
She just wants them to, like, value each other and, like, sit down and eat a meal together. Yeah.
Just be nice to each other. Yeah, that last, the letter was, I was just, because they find this letter after Granny dies that she had written, being like, well, I'm probably dead now, so read this. And it was, like, black tears flowing down my face. It was redunk.
Yep, it was. But, I mean, that was what sort of spurred
the
climax of the film. Mm-hmm. And then just one other thing I wanted to touch on really quickly was, of course, you know, that we are talking about people who are dealing with this virtual world, and there is a little bit of a commentary. But it's a mixed commentary on people's reliance on technology, because obviously when the Oz algorithm is cracked, everything goes crazy. Mm-hmm. But ultimately, the entire world unites to take out a threat.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Digimon. Without... oh my god, Digimon. Yeah.
I'll be okay. So...
What was great about...
okay, but look, let me just... Why it's like Digimon. Literally, frame for frame, that's like... They go into the digital world, you know, and she's in the digital world, and she's like, oh, man, I need all these accounts. And then there's a scene where it goes throughout the world, and everyone's on their computer, and like, you have my blankety blank, and you can literally replace that with digi power or whatever, or you can be like, my account. Like, it's literally shot for shot, and that's why it was hard to, like, ignore that. But.
No, I know you love Digimon.
So I just love Digimon so much.
What I really liked about that is this... That how they treated technology. Yeah. It wasn't like, ooh, all technology's bad.
No,
it's about the networking being good. Yeah. Like it's about your contacts being important and being good. So if you lose, so everyone was, we can't make it to Granny's because we can't figure out because we're trying to use our phones. But then Granny had her physical, like her little address books and stuff, and mm-hmm. she was calling around with a regular phone. And for some reason, everybody had a phone. I guess important military vehicles have like actual like landlines.
I guess so.
Like private lines.
Yeah. So she was just calling everyone like Gumbody.
And like, then she had like a totally like rotary phone too, and she was just like,
it was great.
Gonna dial in those numbers.
Yeah. This is a great movie. Yeah. There's so many great themes.
Yeah, there are.
Included in. Real quick, I want to actually skip to characters and development.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
That fits with what just happened.
Yeah, it does.
Max, tell us about these 5,000 characters.
All right. Well, so, obviously, there are a lot of characters.
20 main characters.
I can't name them all. They're all, it's very complicated. They have a whole thing. Just look it up on Wikia, please.
Yes.
Spare me the trouble. But there are basically uncles, aunts, nephews, nieces, consisting of four generations of people, including the great-grandmother, grandmother, mother, and then I believe Natsuki's generation.
Yes.
With including all the little kids. And so basically...
Side note, the little kids are amazing.
The little kids are great. They're annoying assholes, and I actually believe that the reason that everything goes wrong is because of them. That's all
and,
I'm saying.
Well, and Shota definitely has something to do with it. Too.
Shota's the worst, for just in general.
Yeah.
But also... Yeah, those little kids. Every time something bad happens, if you watch the movie, something bad happens, they're always there. They're always, like, messing with some shit. But there are 27 members, 27. Okay. The people in total.
Yeah.
I believe in just the family. I can't actually remember if that's including Kenji or not. But there's roughly around 27.
Mm-hmm.
And so Kenji's the main character. He's a math whiz, whatever. He was the almost... Japanese representation, representative of Japan, but he
for the math Olympics. Oh, that's what it was.
Yep.
And obviously because of his very careless nature, like even him thinking that like he did crack the code, but everyone realizes that he didn't because he misspells one letter at the end.
So it really wasn't him.
Yeah, so
no,
it wasn't
it's
him.
True. Yeah,
he's actually, his avatar.
Yeah, he's actually falsely accused.
So this whole time, you know, they're just like, he's the criminal. And technically, you know, he did turn into the stuff, and that's why his account got taken, and he's like the avatar or whatever.
Yeah.
But for the most part, you know, that's it. Just plays on the fact that he's not very confident with himself.
Yes, absolutely.
Yeah.
He's and
finding himself in this summer movie.
Exactly. Yes. it's this movie is basically about summer love. Like I like to see like summer love on many different levels.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
yeah.
A familial level. Obviously, like young bud in love, you know,
on a romantic level.
Yeah, and then you know, obviously, human connection and stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
But for me, I just like I'm like, go on, Kawhi, you can get senpai if you want to.
Oh my god. Story of Maxwell.
Yeah, and Natsuki is Kenji's senpai and also the heroine. Let's see, and Kazuma is the 13-year-old second cousin of Natsuki,
who I thought was a girl for like most of the movie, and I was like, "Oh, it's a boy."
Yeah, a boy. I thought it was a girl when I first saw him as well.
Yeah. But you know, obviously, anime boys are basically girls anyway, so it doesn't really matter. Woman. There's no difference.
Yeah, he is.
And he is King Kazuma.
Yep.
Which is, you know, the big bunny dude, best fighter in the world.
On the internet.
Yeah.
On Oz, which best at this fighter. Point is basically the best fighter in the world, it seems like.
Yeah.
Sake, obviously a great grandmother. Wabisuke, I was really happy because I was like, oh man, I'm going to totally put in the whole, like, you know, he is the great grandmother's or great grandfather's illegitimate child, but. You know, Emma ruined it for me.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Still get that moment.
But the whole point is that moment, and you know, that's why he feels like he's an outsider, and they definitely like really do harp on him.
Yeah.
Because it must be that's just like when they reveal that, I was like, oh, no wonder this kid has problems.
Yeah.
Like, who wouldn't have problems?
But also, like, can you imagine coming into this crazy huge family?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, like
who are all legit.
Legitimate, yeah.
Yeah. That, and, I mean, because I mean, just like on a personal note, like my mom is one of five children, all of whom are still married to their original spouses. And my grandparents, you know, were married their whole lives. And so I don't know, I felt a lot of the sort of stuff that you saw in terms of the familial interaction. Mm-hmm. Like, obviously, it's a little different because, you know, this is a very Japanese film. But I've totally been there. Yeah.
I think that's what makes this film pretty great, is even though there is, like, these connotations of Japanese culture, like, it's basically everyone's family.
Yeah.
That's kind of like, you know, there was never a moment where I was like, I cannot relate to this because this is Japanese.
Yeah, like, I agree.
It was always, you know, because they're all silly characters. They're not, like, all the very, like, respectable, you know, like... You know, we all have to bow all the time. You know, they're very normal.
Yeah.
You know, it's very rambunctious. They're not necessarily respectful of each other at all, which is kind of how family is.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just that always makes it, for me, why this movie was so great. I always thought, like, the Oz stuff is almost secondary, you know?
Yeah.
That is just really a problem for a family to solve. But the family dynamic is what makes this meet.
You know,
it's what solves the problem, too.
Yeah, exactly. It does, absolutely.
And then there's Takashi, Sakuma. I don't know why I put him in here, because he's
but
he's Kenji's friend and support and whatever.
He acts as like the introductionary friend.
Yeah. He's also the wingman too.
Yeah, he is.
So,
yeah, he's like the wingman and the narrator.
Yeah,
and
I mean, he's not related to the family, but he helps out Kenji.
He does.
Yeah.
He's
the Izzy of the Digimon movie.
Friggin' Izzy.
And then Love Machine is a rampant AI, obviously, that evolved. Mm. I kind of want to say that, like, in a way, Love Machine also is this thing where, in the beginning, he has no real personality. And through all these conflicts, he actually learns how to be more human. And you can tell that by, at the end, in the beginning, they say that he doesn't actually have any sort of reason to harm people. He just does it, you know?
Yeah.
Like, he doesn't understand what he's doing. And so there's no real idea of him having a consequence or you know, real reason.
Right. Mm.
But then at the end, he, like, very specifically wants to have revenge on the family. Very specifically.
Yeah, you're right.
So, like, he's actually evolved into a person.
I didn't even think about that.
That wants revenge. It has emotions. And he's, like,
emotional. In the scene where he's messing up all the information the first time around, they show him pushing all the data over like dominoes, and all looks, they're all games. I'm just realizing this now.
What?
Yep.
So he's basically, Love Machine has become this thing where like he is out now sour because he lost the game.
Yeah,
he's like an internet troll.
Well, and it was like you were saying that, you know, he started out with no sort of rhyme or reason, and in some ways it sort of echoes the development of a real human child in that like you learn behaviors, and one of the first things that one of your first reactions, I feel like, as a kid when you lose a game
is to be a sore loser.
Yeah, totally.
And that's great. And I always thought that, you know, makes Love Machine way more interesting.
Mm-hmm.
Because in the beginning he was just kind of like this all-powerful entity that just was kind of curious about stuff. But by adding that little touch, I'm like, wow, you gave it a lot more dimension.
Yeah.
You know? It's just sort of a child born from the internet or the net. Yeah. Like, you just don't know, like, that is kind of how AI could be. Like, they could be more human than we would ever expect, and just that quickly, you know?
So interesting.
Yeah. And the Jinouchi family, obviously, is the best character, I think.
Yes.
And so it's like, I say that it's hard to see them as all individual characters. It's more like the one character that is the family. And they all have different, like, aspects of themselves. You know, some is comedy relief. Some is sort of, like, that grounded area. Some is just stuff to, like, relate to, you know, just your family. Because they have so many family members.
Mm-hmm.
There must be some family members in the Jinouchi family that you thought was, oh, that's, like, my brother.
Yeah.
Or that's, like, my nephews or whatever. Yeah. You know, there's always, they all kind of have a different aspect of family that I kind of feel like comes from a very personal place. Or if he is just trying to list it to make it so that is relatable to everyone else.
Yeah.
But for the most part, obviously he nails it.
Yeah. Like,
each of them are so interesting.
It's true, and does it in such a way that, because I mean, with so many characters, a lot of the additional family members don't get to have a whole lot of dialogue.
No.
Yet, by the time that they are all in mortal danger, you feel emotionally attached to all of them on some level.
And also, when you see, you only know like tiny bits about each character, but from their reactions, if you just, depending on what character you happen to be looking at, even if they're not talking, if they're in the scene, they're doing something that shows their personality.
Yeah.
And by the time you get to the point where they show all the the family's avatars, which is a great scene, you're like, oh, that looks exactly like their personality.
Yeah.
Like, the one's a Shinkansen train, and the one kind of like asshole aunt is like this like cutesy little like,
she like, was blonde, like a little blonde
looking thing. And I'm just like, this is perfect. Like, it's perfect. They show, they don't tell.
That's, yes.
That's always beautiful.
Yeah, no, absolutely. That is something that this movie does incredibly well. Though I will say, I do love that one aunt with the really crazy, like, frizzy hair and the glasses that checked up on Kenji in the Oz registry.
Oh, yeah.
Wait, is this the same? We forgot to mention this, but there's a whole other side story happening during this movie of the Koshi and
the baseball team. The baseball team is a weird way of, like, showing that things are happening
outside of the plot, basically.
Yeah. So, like, when they're losing, they're, you know, the whole world is losing. And then, like, when they start to win, they're like, how did they win? It's a miracle.
That's true,
You know? Yeah. And then, you know, everything is okay. And as you progress through the, I think it's, like, the 2 or 3 days, like, that team also, as they have their high points and then, like, low points and the high points and low points.
It's just a beautiful
thing. And it does. It parallels exactly what's happening within the Oz
disaster.
It's a really great device. We kind of, I guess, really quickly, can we talk about our favorite moments in the movie? We're running short of time. It's going to be so great.
There's so much to talk about. It's so good. Favorite moments in the movie. I just love the moment where it's in the after Granny has died and they're all kind of in mourning. And I like the moment when Natsuki is really like losing it and she and Kenji just kind of like connect.
Oh, yeah. Oh, the feels. The feels in that.
And jumping off of that, I love in the last scene of the movie, after everything's going to be okay, and rather than sort of mourning Granny's death, they're celebrating her life.
They're celebrating her birthday,
even though she's dead. And at that point, you know, the family has fully accepted Kenji into their lives. And I love that the aunts try to make Kenji and Natsuki kiss.
Oh, my God.
Because I feel like that's every, like, fangirl ever watching an anime with their two characters that they ship being like, now kiss.
So good.
Very cute. How about you, Max?
I would have to say, I think my favorite part was when they have that like family meal together. I love the when they like that montage too of when they all the family gets together or the men get together and they're like setting up all the things and so they're bringing in the supercomputer and they're smashing everything.
Yeah, well the men are finally doing something. Yeah.
That's my favorite scene too. They're destroying the whole place. Yeah. And the whole house gets destroyed anyway, which is kind of sad. Yeah. But during that scene where before they start setting up, all the brothers are on the phone, and because there's like the policeman, the fisherman, the firefighter, and then the secret army defense guy. So they're like, we can do this, and they're on their phones trying to find. They're like, don't take our 30 years of game experience in vain.
I always thought it was a little weird because it's like they're playing on their phones, and then some people are playing on their DS, and it's just all kind of just works in that world.
Yeah. So real quick, out of five, what would you guys rate this movie?
I'm gonna give it 5 out of 5. Yeah. I love this movie
all around.
I was actually gonna give it a 4 because there's things that I like once I thought about it, I was like, "Oh, that's a little weird," because I am also going off the Digimon movie. I know I've repeated that ad verbatim, but it's a really big deal. Like, it's a huge deal. But I actually have to give it a 5 because the more that I talk about it, it's so many layers that I didn't really get to explore. So,
like an onion, and I think it makes it even better that I also gave it a 5, by the way, that it's even better that this is an original story.
Michelle gave something a 5.
I gave Rurouni Kenshin a 5. Okay.
That's an easy 5, though.
That's an easy. This is great because it's again because it's an original story.
Yeah.
And it's really rare to see an anime movie not based off of other franchises that works and isn't some weird long ass story that you just has an unsatisfying ending.
Yeah, I agree.
Everything that I wanted in a movie.
Yeah.
Without being preachy and too tropey.
Yeah,
I mean, there are some tropes.
Yeah, but no, I agree, and I think that we talked about this a little bit, especially in regards to sort of the message about mankind's reliance on technology. That it's not heavy-handed.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but also it's just a very great human story. It was a good human experience.
You'll laugh, you'll cry a lot. Yeah. I was telling Max whenever I was watching, I was like, I'm crying, I can't stop crying. After Granny dies, I cried until the end of the movie. I was just like a freaking mess.
Yeah.
It was great. So I think we all gonna say, definitely go watch this movie.
Yes, watch it.
Read the manga, watch the Digimon movie.
Yeah, thank you guys so much for joining us. Say thank you for filling for Yume and
absolutely.
Jonathan.
Thanks for having us.
Don't forget, you can download all of our episodes via iTunes as well.
Ooh.
I kind of didn't look at that until today, and I was excited to see that.
You can listen to us in the car.
You can find information about the hosts and about the next show we're doing on our Facebook, also at facebook.com/otakumovieacademy. And our next episode, this is our last one for the year. So our next episode is going to be on January 6th at 8 p.m. back at our Wednesday 8 p.m. slot with all of our original hosts. You guys, you might see these guys like this too. Thank you guys so much for joining us. You can find me at I am ChubbyBunny.
You can find me at Emma Fyffe.
And you can find me at Super Otaku.
All right, thanks guys, and we'll see you next time at Otaku Movie Anatomy.
Producers Maria Menounos, Kevin Undergaro, Phil Svitek, and the entire Popcorn Talk Network. We would like to thank you for tuning in. For questions or comments, be sure to visit popcorntalk.com. I'm Sir Richard Wentworth, and this has been a presentation of the Popcorn Talk Network.
The views expressed herein are those of the hosts only and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Popcorn Talk Network or its owners or principals.